My Stirling Single, piping the first of the live steam injectors. In the last episode, I left the injector in a very high position, and although this is where I would normally fit an injector, just below the running board, for a Stirling Single it's a bit too high. That's why I only fitted one pipe. In this clip, I'm bending the pipe to drop the injector's position a bit lower. It's still higher than on the full size, but then again it's entirely different anyway. This is a very strange engine. It's never been painted, but it's been run. And the water feed was taken care of by the axle-driven pump and the hand pump that's fitted in the tender. What I'm doing at the moment is just trimming the footplate because I need to make a little bit of room for some more piping to go through. The footplate is made from aluminium, so it's very easy to work. Here I'm using my Proxon motor tool with a small drum sander to profile the shape. A piece of copper pipe that will supply the water feed to the boiler needs to pass through the footplate. This footplate is held to the running boards by two bolt holes at the back. What I need to do is make it so that when it fits up against the cab, there's some sort of an angle bracket to hold it in position there. Luckily, there is a sufficient gap between the footplate and the top of the frames to allow this piece of 5/32 of an inch pipe to pass through. Although it won't be fitted like this, it will run underneath the footplate. Time to bend the pipe into the correct position to go from the injector to the special check valve junction that I've yet to make. There's a far easier way of bending the pipe, that is, without bending it in the wrong place. Get a roll of round section plumber's solder, bend that to shape, and then copy where the bends are. I don't take any credit for this method of pipe bending. It originally came from an LBSC article covering pipe bending for miniature steam locomotives. Here you can see the final pipe layout, and you notice that it goes across the frames just underneath where the footplate's going to be. Once I fit this other end of the pipe to the check valve adapter, I will find the point exactly where it's going to pass over the frames, and at this point I will grind a recess to accommodate the pipe. Because if I do it this way and the pipe is touching the frames, vibration could cause problems by rubbing through the copper pipe. These small Jubilee fittings injectors have removable cones at each end. But don't worry, you can't get them the wrong way round because they're a different size, but you can lose them, so always be very careful and make sure if you put the injector back in the drawer, at least screw a union nut onto the end to hold the cone securely in place. When making piping for things like injectors, bear in mind that you will have a union nut on both ends, so make sure that the pipe will go where you want it to go with a union nut on the end. Now there are two pipes connected to the injector. On the right hand side is a steam inlet from the tap, and the left hand side is the return feed of the water to the boiler. At this point there was a knock on the door, and a man arrived with some steam engines. A large twin Tangi engine, a 504 boiler, a Stuart 1010V and the Stuart 10H model. And just in case you're not aware, the V stands for vertical and the H stands for horizontal. He bought these engines via eBay. Initially the 10H wouldn't run because the timing was miles out, so I tweaked it a little bit and then I got it to run. It uses a brass screw to hold the eccentric sheave to the crankshaft, which is no good because brass doesn't bite into the steel of the crankshaft. It needs to be a steel grub screw. This engine is not very well made and it really does need new studs. I put some 7BA nuts on the studs, but they were a rattle fit. And I really don't know why one of the drain cocks is fitted into the steam chest, but anyway, that's how it goes. I've slowed down the video and you can clearly hear that there is air blowing past the piston, so that definitely needs some attention. The small 10H is okay really, it's good experience for a beginner to rebuild this, not difficult to do, and a fairly good starting point. This engine, once again bought via eBay, is a real mess. This is a double Tangi engine. I don't know what it's doing with aluminium pistons. By the way, aluminium pistons in a cast iron cylinder in a steam engine is not a good idea. The owner of this engine was telling me that when he bought it, it was painted and it actually ran, although it was a bit lumpy and it didn't run very well. So he stripped all the paint off it and now here it is. And unfortunately, it's horrible. When he reassembled the engine after removing the paint, it wouldn't go at all. And that's really what he's doing in my workshop. He brought this engine for me to rebuild. We'd corresponded a few times via email and he sent me some photographs of it and it looked bad on the photographs. That's why it's on the bench and it's actually much worse than I thought it was going to be, so it's a good job that I didn't quote for doing this job after just looking at the photographs. There are so many things wrong with this engine, too numerous to mention. For instance, look at the angle of the connecting rod to the crank pin. I said to the owner of this engine, the best thing you can do with this is just put it back on eBay as it is and describe it in the listing as spares or repair. It is rebuildable, it is repairable, but it would be impractical for me to do it. On the positive side, the 1010V he bought via eBay wasn't too bad. The crankshaft is weak though, it's held together with roll pins. So a cautionary word for beginners to the hobby, be very careful when you buy things online when all you've seen is a photograph. Rebuilding this engine successfully is far in advance of the capabilities of a beginner. And that's it for doom and gloom, back to the pipe bending. Time now to make the water inlet piping to the injector. I really must try and buy some 4mm round section solder. It would make the job a whole lot easier. As it turns out, the water inlet pipe, which needs to go to a main junction panel at the back, was by far the easiest piece of pipe bending so far. This water piping follows the underside of the left-hand frame. At the rear of the engine, this piece of pipe bends upwards and then outwards, where it will be fastened to a bracket at the back. The question now is, can I withdraw the dump pin? And the answer is, yes, it comes out okay. It's a bit of a tight fit. But then again, it doesn't need to have such a large hexagon head on it. If I turn that down, it will pull out of the mounting bracket very easily and just slip past the injector. So I'm pleased about that because I quite like the method of mounting the ash pan on this engine. And that's it from me for the moment. Thanks for watching and I hope you found it useful.